So in this next session, we'll just have a quick look at parts of the memory hierarchy, particularly in the serial fashion, that are the cache and the TLB. The TLB is not something that we normally really spend much time with. And here, we're just going to be showing you a quick trick, so to speak, that sometimes can improve your application performance that doesn't require much effort at all. So the important first slide is just simply to say this. Go back many years, and everyone was obsessed with floating point performance. And if you go back far enough, floating point performance was all the limiting factor. Getting the data to the floating point units was never really a problem. That era died quite some time ago. Now we're more and more getting to the stage where the flops are free, or a lot of processing power is free, and memory bandwidth and memory accesses are what is really the problem. Memory accesses, memory bandwidth, memory sizes, they're not able to grow at the same rate as we've been able to get away with Moore's law, the processing power increase that we've had. So most applications that we see need to find a better way of using the memory hierarchy, better way of using the cache, the translation, lookaside buffer, etc. So a cache hierarchy. So some of you may be quite familiar with this, but some of you may be less so. So because accessing main memory is quite slow, and that's main memory that's local, we've just seen that actually we can get a diagram to say that some memory is further away than other memory on a multi-core, multi-socket node, but even local memory, accessing it is slow. It takes hundreds of clock cycles. You could be getting on with something else. So particularly for that latency effect, many years ago people started to put in these local little stores that reflected what's out in main memory for some recently used data. These are called caches and began with just one level of cache, of course. Well, we actually use cache for two reasons. One is that latency effect, certainly, but also if you have a very small piece of memory and you put it on the processor, you can actually get much higher bandwidth to it as well. So you would typically have several levels of this cache. Now, we operate all our instructions have to operate on registers, floating point operations, and so on. And these, the number of registers we have may be of the order of 32, 64 registers. If you look at assembly listings, then it's dealing with registers. Things such as GPUs, they actually have enormous register sets. So much more actually larger than their caches. But here with CPUs, we have a few registers. Then we have the processor core, and then we go out to our caches. And we have different levels of cache. So L1 cache is typically very small, very high bandwidth, and low latency. It may be that it's going to take only two or three clock cycles to grab data from that L1 cache. And if you recall me saying that we can do this out of order operations to many, many more cycles than that, typically the L1 cache latency is never going to be a problem. And the bandwidth is typically very high. Then we go down to a second level cache, and then maybe a third level cache. And by the time we get out to these lower level of cache, we keep building up more and more levels of cache, you tend to find that these levels are shared with other processors. So a cache is not something that you have control over. It's not like if anybody's had experience with GPUs, shared memory, where you can control it. This is something where it's just the processor itself is saying, you've just had some data, I'm going to leave it around because you might need it again. So this needing it again or needing similar data gives us two aspects of cache that we're interested in. Recently used data has a high likelihood in many applications that you're going to use it again. So it stays behind, so we can have something called temporal locality. It's going to be used again in a time local sense, as in it may be that in 30 clock cycles into the future, you're going to come back to that piece of data. We want to keep it there. The other thing that we have in many of our applications, or any application that's going to get really good high performance, is We go through data in a quite regular fashion. Okay, so this means that we're doing the same thing, the same set of instructions, to lots and lots and lots of pieces of data. And this can be just streaming through memory, grabbing the next piece of data, doing exactly what we did to the piece of data before. Maybe two or three arrays, and we're adding A and B together to form C, element by element. So there's a good chance that if you had to get access to a piece of data somewhere, you also will need the surrounding data or some data nearby. This is what we call spatial locality. So often algorithms just go through adjacent elements of memory. Sometimes you might actually jump a little further. And this is why we have these levels of cache, for our spatial locality and our temporal locality. Now, what's the characteristics of the caches? Well, there's an expense with getting caches smaller and higher bandwidth and lower latency, and that's why we don't just simply have a very big fat cache sitting on the processor. There's a lot of transistors. If you look at modern multi-core processors, you'll find that the actual execution units only take up a smallish part of the die at times, and there's a lot of other stuff there, and that's all these caches. Now, caches also have an important effect in terms of how we actually load data into them. So if we say, I just want to load a particular byte at a particular memory location, to do with that spatial locality that we talked about, and also particularly the way that memory works. So this is electrical engineering. I would go and ask an electrical engineer, because this is not my field. But I do know enough of reading just to know what I need to know here about how it works. It's very expensive out in memory to actually grab one piece of data, because typically the memory fires up effectively a large band of different memory locations, and then you only grab a piece of them. It may be something like, I think, 4,000 bits or whatever get fired up at a time, and you grab whatever you need. So in order to amortize that cost, you don't just grab one bit, bytes. The memory hierarchy tries to grab a bigger chunk of data at a time, and this is what we call a cache line. So we may only want this little piece of data here, but when we make that load, the cache hierarchy says, well, I'm going to go and load that and the surrounding data, the line that contains that. Where it defines the line, it will be on some power of two boundary. So it may be that it finds the closest 64-byte or 128-byte or whatever boundary, and then it loads in for 64, 128 bytes, etc., whatever. These cache line lengths can differ from machine to machine. You'd want it as small as possible, because if you're jumping around in memory, that's a problem if it loads in too much that you're never going to use. On the other hand, efficiency means that the larger that cache line can be, if you're going to use it, the better. What this means as well, though, in terms of observed memory bandwidth is you measure from your application, here's how many loads and stores I made, how long did it take me to actually get through all those. That's what I see as memory bandwidth. That's different to what actually the hardware is issuing, because if the hardware has to issue, I'm going to load into my cache 64 bytes, let's say, at a time, but you've only used one of them, it's actually loaded those 64 bytes. And then the next thing you go, it loads another 64 bytes. The hardware could be doing a lot more work, but you don't see it, you don't care. You only want the data that you actually need. So your observed memory bandwidth is much lower if you're not using all the data in all those cache lines once they've been loaded. And the other aspect of the cache lines is they can differ from different levels of your memory hierarchy or your cache hierarchy. It may be that at some lower level, you might actually load a cache line of 128 bytes. And as you get to lower and lower cache lines, it gets closer to the memory. It's 64 or 32 bytes. This isn't normal these days, but it's possible to do such a thing. So The cache is typically loaded to a high level of cache when you want it. It takes it straight there, and then it gets pushed down to one of those other levels further down. There's different types of caches, but this is effectively what we're interested in, the cache line. So because it changes our observed memory bandwidth, we're interested in making sure we can get the best use of it. So let's first of all take a look at cache lines from a practical point of view and see what we see as observed memory bandwidth if we start jumping further and further through memory. Okay, so let's begin with an exercise. That's why we needed to make sure all those three machines were accessible to us. Now, actually, you only need to use, to do comparisons, you only need two of these machines. Pick either a Rosa or a Turdy node and a Pilatus node, because we're on a single core. And these two, from the point of view of the single core, are identical. So it's probably easier to get the Turdy node, because that's the one which there's nobody on and so on. It's just nice and convenient. Instructions on how to load the modules for the Intel and GNU compilers are on the instruction sheets. And if you therefore just go into this rather long line, you should then be able to find this this file. You may wish to put in an alias or something in your .bashrc file for this course directory, something that comes up to about here, because you'll notice this is where you got the slides from and so on, and it's rather a long path. Also, for those who are Fortran programmers, because actually we're not actually modifying this code, we just have the one version, a C version, just because you can still probably easily read it, and we're actually interested in the results that come out of this thing, not the code itself. Okay. Is that clear? Or...
Copy that.
Yeah, just copy it somewhere else, because you won't be able to write in that directory. Yeah. So if you copy all of those three, because you'll need all of those in the next. What? You're running on the login node. No. You should. So, yes. But. For all of these things, when we say run the code, that means get a SELOC session. And then do either app run or S run, depending on which machine you're on. So two of us were discussing earlier how to remember if it's app run or S run. Pilatus ends in an S, you need S run. Everything else, you need app run. Rosa ends in an A, so that's also easy for app run, but Turdy is the one that throws us in a little, unfortunately. I mean, you can run this on the login node if you wished, but we're interested in really seeing what happens on these modern multi-core, highly multi-core processors. You've got a seg fault. Oh dear. You've compiled with the cray.
Yeah.
Oh. Please try, yeah. I tried with both and it seemed to work. Yes, you just copy the files to some directory, create a directory in your course account, copy the files over because you won't be able to write in that directory, it's a shared directory. So for Cray, yeah, you don't need the OpenMPD, it's already there, but anyway. Seg fault. I didn't get a seg fault. Did I try with the course account? Oh. I tried most of these with course accounts to make sure. It's great that you're reporting. Is there anything in the file? You have to put an exclamation mark in the front, don't you? Yes, there is. So, do the... I'm looking at the clock. Maybe 23. Try 23. Yeah, but it's points, not... Okay, but that's what you did. I should check that, shouldn't I?
Apparently,
I must have made a change just before putting this on somewhere. This 22 should be maybe 23 if you can't plot. Thanks, Themis. You can see the same thing from the text file, but sometimes plotting things, of course, is... This. Does anybody have any problems? No? You saw a seg fault. It probably after it's finished running. Yeah. Mm. How long should it take? Sorry?
A minute.
Yeah. It should be spitting out some data to the screen. Yeah. You could finish it a little earlier, but I just wanted to... So it goes up to about... Even on the shortest case, it's 64 megabytes of data. That's why, actually, the seg fault may occur if you run out of memory. Yep. Okay, that might be a possible reason for an issue. But 64 megabytes is more than you would normally get in any cache. So that's the reason for actually running to, well, I think it's 64, it's either that or maybe 25 megabytes, which is still more than you get in most caches these days. So that's the reason to run beyond that level, even for the shortest. So where does the graph flatten out then, would you say? Have people been able to plot the graph? No? Okay, I'll leave you to plot the graph. What's it doing?
Yeah.
Sure, because, okay, when you say explain again, I didn't explain, so I should explain. So what it's doing is as follows. So anybody who can read the C code, it might be understandable. What we do is we begin by saying, okay, we're gonna load data. And remember that it said that caches are designed, as much of what we have is designed, to get contiguous data. To get data, you're just going through memory. So what this does is instead it says, okay, we begin by just loading the next piece of data. And then we jump 2, and then we jump 3, and we jump 4, and we jump 5 between each one. And what we're trying to see is what's the sort of effective bandwidth that we, the application programmer, see if we keep skipping all this other data that we don't use, because we're loading cache lines. And then the point about where does the graph flatten out is, okay, at what point have we already saturated this? What point does it really not matter anymore? Because now we're, whatever we load, we're going to a brand new cache line every time anyway. You mean when you're programming? So when you're programming, it's a case of if the memory address of your thing, if you've declared an array, then A0 and A1, if it's a one-dimensional array, for example, are next to each other, and A and so on and so forth. A0 and A4 will be three, whatever it is, it's doubles, chars, whatever, apart. So that's how we know. And so it's a case of if you were to write a piece of code and you wanted to stride through memory, said, look, I don't need this rest of this stuff, then what's the effect? Particularly important is as follows. These machines are designed that if you're going to work on some piece of data, whatever the array is, let's say pressure or temperature or something, that your loop will go through and work on those pieces of data. You just want to keep repeating the same instructions. I'm working on a piece of on pressure, blah, 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 with some other things. If that's all out in one array, pressure, and you just go sequentially through, then you'll be able to get good performance. But what happens if instead you decide, aha, I want to go in for a nice design where I'm going to encapsulate certain pieces of data, put these all together for one grid point, pressure, temperature, da, 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 all together in a little struct or a Fortran data type or whatever. What's now the effect on your program when you go along and say struct dot or in Fortran sort of percentage pressure? So it will be array reference dot or array reference percentage, and then that thing. And then you go to the next one. Now, if you've got a structure of data type, you're jumping through memory to the next one. What's the effect on your bandwidth? What's the effect on your application of doing that? That's what we're determining here by looking at the cache lines. Effectively, that description is what to say, try not to do. Okay. So has it finished, and have you, anybody? It's still working. Oh, dear. No? Okay. It's still running. Yeah.
So there's a data would just crash on 18.89.
It shouldn't have done. So well, it didn't for me. That's when I checked again yesterday, and unfortunately, oh well. The Intel one tends to be a bit faster, that's all. The other reason as well. So. Thank you for reminding that, yes. So yeah, I care, but nobody else does, yeah. Scientists. By the way, which, yeah, so, but you're running on the compute node. Yeah, you're doing the app run, S run.
Yes.
Okay. On which machine? You're on Turdy, okay. Don't really understand why it would crash, because it didn't for me. But I was checking on Rosa. If it's taking a long time and not getting anywhere, it should go up to 256, by the way. Okay, that on the first number on the line, whatever, should say that the gap is 256, I think. That's just so we go as high as is reasonable to get an idea of where the cache line is. But I can tell you it's much lower than that. The cache line double is a much quicker thing because we're jumping in terms of how many doubles through memory, so we only do it for a much shorter range. So if this is taking too long, just move on to cache line double. That could be the case. Just pointed out to me that actually, I told a bit of a lie. I forgot when saying that I ran this on Rosa, but I didn't use GCC ICC. I loaded the programming environment for GNU or the programming environment for Intel. So, if on the sheet you'll see you can select a compiler with module load prigenv Intel prigenv GNU. If you do that and then issue the command CC. It includes a little extra few things and some different wrappers and so on. And that's what I was doing. But I left it on here like this because on Pilatus you would run it like this. So. Does anyone have a graph? Yep. Okay. Where does the graph flatten out? The first one. Yep, that will be fine. About six. Yeah, okay. That's exactly. I actually found that it was more like about probably 70 to 80 by the time it actually, but that's an, it's sort of like a little artifact. As we said, these things are going to be in blocks. So it's 64, is exactly right. And 64 bytes is a typical cache line size, and it's what you would see on both of these processors, and many processors, in fact. There are some that use 128 bytes still. And so what that means in that case is if you were loading just one byte, because that's what it's doing, the memory bandwidth that you can see from that single core is down to about, 70 megabytes per second? Was that the sort of number you saw? Yeah, more or less. On the graph as well, do you see a little slight spike up a couple of times? Yeah? If you can tell me what that's for, I'd be very interested to know. Okay, there are certain effects that occur anyway when you get close to a power of two boundary. But normally they're ones that actually decrease performance rather than increase performance, to do with cache associativity and other issues. And if you've been able to run this on multiple machines, on Pilatus as well as just on the one machine so far. Okay. So if you move on to the cache line double, just because it runs quicker, and we'll get the same results. Yes, sorry, that was wrong. It's presumably not got. Yes, sir. I'm afraid it is, and I don't know how to get around that quickly.
By the way, either for the browser, it can be in difference, or the ICC and DCC.
Yes, in that case, that's why I said that actually I did differently. Yes, that's great. If it works, that's fine. It's but there's a wrapper called CC that we normally use for compiling for the compute nodes, and that may be related. Jean-Guillaume pointed out to me to why some of people are seeing segmentation faults. But we do need to check whether you can launch an X term. Could you just get out of that and do X term and see if you can launch something? Okay. You did do the minus Y, did you, when you logged in?
Yeah.
I think you do. Yes, you do. Unfortunately, you can try and set up an SSH key, and maybe if it's helpful. But. And don't do X term and just see if it. No. Okay. Need to get somebody to look at that. Maybe Jean-Guillaume could help. Can you help him get X? It's Mac, it's all fine. But he's doing SSH minus Y, but it's just not forwarding, so maybe there's something in the SSH preferences and so on. Otherwise, we won't be able to use reveal or anything else. So we're able to see on these graphs, The 64 bytes still sticks to be about right. What about the bandwidths between the two processes? Yeah? Yeah. Once you've gone beyond the cache line, you're already in trouble, is the way I would put it. You're already in the place where you're at the low memory bandwidth line. And if it's 5 or 10 megabytes per second difference, it really wouldn't make much difference. Your optimization strategy is to try and get into the cache lines, not to worry too much. Why is it still going down? So part of that will relate to the TLB. Which we'll mention shortly, in terms of how far into the future, when it gets a rhythm going, it can actually see. So I'll have to mention, I have to get to where we can talk about how memory is paged and what you can see into the future before we're able to really explain that. In terms of it continuing to go down, I'm perfectly comfortable with that, and I fully understand why that would happen. I just have those little up points seem a little too strange for me. Once you're in that range, it doesn't really matter. You're already suffering. You're already dead. Yeah. But the other thing is with when loading you've done the double precision as well, have you? Right, because the thing with the double precision is you're loading now 8 bytes at a time, so you start off if you are contiguous, at a much higher memory bandwidth. Agreed. Loading smaller units is always a problem anyway, because every one of those instructions, particularly if you're loading 1 byte, there's a lot of extra overhead in the processor. It just grabs one at a time, and it just gets low performance anyway. So we try not to do that. Yeah. Where do those little peaks come from? That's what I'm saying. If anybody knows where those little peaks come from. Exactly. The point is that they come. Exactly. Yeah. Now, normally, that actually causes you a problem. Because when you get towards a power of 2 number, then there's something called cache associativity normally hits you. Okay, and that is to do with how when you actually, there's only certain places within your cache normally that the cache line can go. Okay, for efficiency reasons, it's maybe say 4 slots on a bookshelf type of thing, but anywhere else, then you have to remove one of the books and put something else. In this example, it wouldn't affect you. Okay. It could well be. It would. So like I said, if you've got any idea why it happens, then come back and let me know. That would be great. Yeah. It's still segfault.
Segfault 89. Same thing. Segfault.
89 times this. Okay. I'm not quite sure then. It's not going out of memory, otherwise the GCC wouldn't work. Yeah. Oh. Excellent. No, you can get as many times as you want. That's fine. Yeah, so you can get another one to and then have the graph. Okay, so let's move on from this. You've seen a difference between the Cray and the Sandy Bridge as well from bandwidth point of view? Presumably? One higher than the other? Probably. Okay. So... The doubles, you will have noticed, you got a higher bandwidth to begin with anyway, because you were loading in more data. And then it should stay higher because you're loading in 8 bytes anyway of each cache line. Whereas with when we did with the single byte, we got 1 byte of every 64 bytes. Our application sees a very poor performance. Even if we're loading a double and we're only loading one, then we get 8 out of every 64 bytes are going to be usable. But it still makes our performance suffer. So that's the cache line. And the important thing, as we just had a brief discussion earlier, one of the things this has an effect on is how you lay out your data structures. So for performance reasons, it's better to not do what's actually probably nicer, particularly for people who've got used to encapsulation, people often using structs, classes, for example, in C++ would be a common way of doing things, where you want to lay out, I'll have X, Y, Z coordinates and all sorts of other things, and then go and grab these things one by one in your loop, because you'll be throwing away a lot of other data typically. So unfortunately, it's better to have the Fortran 77 type approach of big arrays and finding some way of getting through the data in that way. An unfortunate fact of life, because it does limit what we can do in some ways. If you do it that way, you're much more likely to be able to get much better utilization of all the data that you load. So the next thing that we move on to is the fact, yes? Yes.
So, well, what we were discussing is, so we have known this test.
Yep.
So what's the take-home message about
that? The take-home message is that with cache lines, so you can see from there the length of the size of a cache line.
Okay.
The cache line determines, it determines how much data you've got to try and get reused, otherwise you throw away. If your cache line, you went onto a new architecture and you did a similar test and found the cache line was 256 bytes, you're now in the regime where you know you'll really get killed. Your memory bandwidth would really suffer if you were loading only one double per cache line. So what I just said about try not to do this thing with structs and classes and so on, if you've got a double, or even maybe two or three of these together, in your class and you're going to load them all in, then with a 64-byte cache line, you might say, well, I'm throwing away half of my memory bandwidth, but I can get away with that for four doubles. If you find your cache line is 256 bytes, you really wouldn't want to do it, because now you're only getting one out of every 16 or so bytes. Rose is down. Okay. So we may have to have a reboot of one of the machines.
But find out.
Yeah, which one of you took our machine down, our flagship machine? Okay, not likely. Yeah, we'd like to know how to create problems. So that's one thing. The real thing is to just give you an idea of if you do miss large amounts of data in terms of if you're not getting good spatial locality, what is the performance hit that you'll get? And you'll saw that you've gone down in one case from probably, if it was contiguous in memory, even with the bytes, you won't get very good memory bandwidth simply because of the fact you're only grabbing 1 byte at a time. But you can get 1 gigabyte per second, and that will fall to about 70 megabytes per second. So that's the sort of impact that you would get. In the double precision case, I think it's more like 4 or 5. And this is, I'm talking now on 2D, for example. 4 or 5 gigabytes per second down to maybe 500 megabytes per second or thereabouts. That's the sort of impact. It's just to give you an idea of the impact if you have your data laid out in a poor way. Good for your design, maybe bad for performance. So the next thing we're just going to look at then is the cache size and the bandwidth that we can get. And this is then just to see the effect of cache size and bandwidth. And also, Possibly not now, because I was going to try and get a comparison between the AMD and the Intel, but if the machines are down, it's a little difficult to do. So cache sizes and bandwidth. So we've got these different caches, L1, L2, L3, as we'd mentioned. They're different on different machines. Okay, so it may be that one machine has a 16 kilobyte L1 cache, and the next one may have a 64K L1 cache. L2 and L3 can also differ. Sometimes, if you're actually really, really running on multi-core mode, then a shared cache, such as the L3 cache, well, it becomes a little vague as to how much of it you can expect to get yourself. If there are eight of us sharing the 16 megabyte L3 cache, we can expect about 2 megabytes, but it's now in a heuristic fashion because we don't control it. Cache bandwidths can differ from machine to machine. So we've got memory bandwidth that we can measure by just doing a stream benchmark, just streaming through memory. We can do the same thing with our caches and see what's the bandwidth that we can expect. And different processes have different bandwidths. So although I said that typically getting from registers L1 data from L1 into your registers, the latency is very fast. The bandwidth should also be very fast, should also be wide enough to keep you busy. But that's not actually the case at all, necessarily, in some architectures. So just looking at the differences in architectures and what you therefore should expect from an architecture is something we'll just do now. So here's an example of two different things. Another important aspect as well is that we can get these nice bandwidths, fat bandwidths, particularly when we get to the lower levels, the L3, and the memory bandwidth. You'll typically find that a single core cannot saturate the bandwidth of a processor, not the memory bandwidth anyway. Typically also maybe not the L3. So if, for example, we had a processor that may have 30 gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth, it may be that a single core can actually only get 10 gigabytes per second, and you need to get multiple cores before you can saturate. So we'll just do a simple, quick, hopefully quick, example now, just to look at what we can see on Pilatus, if we can't get access to the other machine, of the cache size and bandwidth. And this does a similar thing to before in terms of changing, where before we were looking at gaps as we went through memory. Now we're doing something slightly different. We're always loading the same amount of doing the same number of loads and stores, but over an increasing little block. So if we have a small block, say 10 kilobytes, we do it a huge number of times. If we're going over 10 megabytes, we do that fewer times, so the same number of load stores. And then we can measure cache bandwidths, and hopefully on a graph maybe see where we can see the boundaries of certain caches. And I hope you can get on the crane machine. Yeah, we don't need any scrap. It's more a case if they have to take the machine down. No? Okay. Is Pilatus available?
Yeah, but I'm running on Pilatus.
Oof. Okay.
Do you want an AMD system?
No. I'll just say what the AMD system's like. Once, if you can do the example on Pilatus, then that will be fine. You're on. Maybe it's one. It depends on the login node you're on, then, maybe. Or maybe if you've already got a live session, you're okay. Oh, you've just looked. Which node of Turdy does it tell you? Two.
Yeah,
can you?
Two.
Okay. If you explicitly log into Turdy 2.
No. If it doesn't return the prompt, it's asked for the Let's just say if you can get a
Okay. Right. Great. Sorry? I believe they should. Yes, all of these I've got an fprintf and a printf. So, but sometimes, but when I tried this last, oh, there you go. Sometimes, for some reason, the flush doesn't necessarily work that well on the Cray machine with app run. So in other words, even if I put a, that's not app run. Oh, that's in Pilates. Oh.
And it's not without sigfold.
Without, okay. Those. No, oh, yeah. GNU plot. No GNU plot? It
seems so. Now I can try to log into the other.
Turdy is up if you log into Turdy 2.
Can I explicitly choose?
Yes. Doesn't affect the code.
Okay.
It's because I've declared it as a long and it's looking for the nice. The format statement gives this warning when you're compiling. It doesn't actually bother, it doesn't affect the code. Yeah, couldn't be bothered putting, never got around to putting the L in or whatever. The emergency shutdown. Cooling problem. Oh, okay. System will be shutting down. Right, okay. So let's ignore that one and go on to Pilates. Was that with GNU or with Intel? Which? Yes, but with GCC or ICC? GCC. Okay, can you go for ICC now? But that's, it didn't seem as many enough points actually, but yeah, it looks about right. You what? Yeah. Sorry about that. Well, Rosa had cooling problems. Sorry. Well, I don't know whether the center had or some. There was some cooling problem, so Rosa did emergency shutdown. Turdy, I don't know. I don't know why Turdy would need to be shut down. No idea. At 12:30. Okay, can you type in module load prigend intel. Yep.
Why can't I open GNU plot in Pilates?
I don't know. So there's some. I didn't check that it was there. Is there a GNU plot on Pilates? There probably isn't. Okay. Which means that on Ayla.
Oh, Ayla.
It doesn't plot. Okay, probably easier on Ayla. Just log into Ayla again and try plotting from there. I'll leave that one for you. Pilates still works. What, Rosa?
Down.
Yeah, Turdy down.
Dines
down. So it's a site wide. Okay, so Pilates will stay up.
I don't know.
We may have to have a. It's all right, lunch is here if we can keep. You know, we just break early.
No, but don't you need also Rosa's at some
point? Yeah. As long as it's good for tomorrow. It's what, sorry? Yeah, I just thought people would. Okay. Can you do? This is from your, but this is to do with your. This is to do with you. I don't mean you personally. I mean, I don't understand why you would have a locale issue. $LC and then just see if that's got anything. Yeah, try, is it LC? Just press return and see if it does anything. I'm not sure whether. This gentleman has a problem again with his locale now, I think. ICC doesn't work, yeah. I don't know if it's. We don't know why. So, the plot can be done on Ayla. Just I was informed anyway, I didn't put the numbers down. Apparently it's using 4:14, I think, is are the correct numbers. But the, to pick up the X and the Y, the correct X and Y from the GNU plot. It was before it was 5 and 23. This one, it's different. I just said, what, it's 4? It's not 4 and 22. Oh, is it? Okay, 4 and 22 sounds more likely. Yeah. I want the last one. Okay, 4 and 22. Good. So you've got a plot. Okay, so you've got a plot. Okay, right. So you see what? The cache bandwidth increasing? And at what point does it sort of stop and go down again? It's how much the block size?
15 minutes.
15 minutes. 1.5 million is when it goes down. It 1.5 million. Or 15 million. Okay, 15 million is when it goes down. Has it gone down before that? Right. Okay. So it drops shortly after the beginning. Okay, and that's with GNU. Sorry. Does anybody have the Intel compiler? Yep. You have the Intel compiler. And what do you see? This. Okay, so you've plotted. Numbers at the left are very, very strange.
Yes.
You get something different. What do you get?
Drops down, isn't it?
Yeah, that's strange.
Okay, I don't know. No, this is only, for me, this is only Pilatus. Because okay, it's different. What do you get out of this? Not the same answers that I got. That's what you get out of this. But what you can see is, so you're seeing, as you said, 1.5 e to the 7, 15 million. And then it drops at 20 million. Okay, so what you're seeing there is the last level cache. Okay. On Pilatus, we have 20 megabytes of L3 cache. So if you start to go just beyond that cache, remember, we're repeating and repeating and repeating. We do one lot of loads. And then once we've done the loads, then if we go back to the beginning and do it again, all that data is in cache. So what you're seeing is, what's the sort of maximum size that you can get some benefit still out of having your data in cache? Now, you should have seen an effect, particularly with the Intel compiler. I was hoping you'd see the effect at about 256 kilobytes, which may be hidden in those early numbers. You may be able to see from the raw data. ICE could see this, certainly. So that's why I'm a little concerned. Because that's when you get to the level of the L2 cache, which has got a higher bandwidth again. Okay, so it should increase up until about 256 kilobytes and then drop if you look at the raw data. Right. Okay. No, I'm lost for words because it should have a much more dramatic effect than that at 256K, but it shows up much better on the Intel compiler. This is the Intel one. So it should be about this range. So those people who've got on their Intel plots, you may see it gets to about 40 gigabytes per second right near the beginning. The raw data, does the raw data, instead of the graph, what does it say at about 200, 100? You could do a lot. Yeah. And then you can see it. Okay. I didn't want to give the instruction for GNU plot for the log, so I thought I'd let. But you can see it. Oh, so what do you get at about up to 200 and something?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's about 200 something. And what's the gigabytes per second you see there? Oh, what's the last number you get in the line? Sorry, no, on the line, an output line.
8,000.
Okay. You should be looking at more like about 40 gigabytes per second, I think. If you look at the raw data with the Intel compiler, yeah, down here we're about 40 gigabytes per second.
That's right, and they say that
for a block size of it's for the block size, and if you then go down, then it drops off at its first drop off is at 32K, and then it drops off again further down. So, what I was hoping you would see, but you have to do a log plot, or you have to instead just look at the raw data, is you should see, if you're lucky, you will be able to see three points here. One is at 32K, approximately. One is at about 250K, and then one is at something like 20 megabytes. And those are the cache levels. And each case, the single core is able to get quite a lot of data bandwidth from each level of cache, and it diminishes as you go down. So what's the purpose of this? Well, this is, if you can keep your data in that little region, certainly if you can keep it in 32K, you get a certain performance to be able to just load and store data at very, very fast rate. Then at 256K, the next, and so on. So Gilles is going to do an example this afternoon, including some blocking. Yeah. So he will show that how that effect, that blocking effect, in an example, in a real example, can actually demonstrate improvement in performance. Okay. So the point is that if you have some data, if you can somehow say, well, I'm going to try and rearrange my algorithm to work on a piece of data where I've got to reuse it in a certain block size before moving on to the next block, you'll get much better bandwidth, much better performance. The Intel processor, you should be able to see those numbers, particularly with the Intel compiler, from the raw data. The AMD is just nowhere near as good. The AMD is very difficult to actually even see sometimes that there's a cache there. So the final thing I want to just touch on at the moment, and this one's a little bit more for free from what we're going to show you. Hopefully you'll be able to see this one. But with the machines down, I'm not quite sure. Is something called the translation lookaside buffer. So the cache is the most well-known piece of the memory hierarchy when you go outside the memory on the processor. But from way back in the 1950s and 60s and so on, people started to work on something called virtual memory. And this is the idea that you can give out memory addresses, and then you have, it may be, for example, a lot of processors might all begin their memory addresses at zero and then go up to, say, 1K or whatever. Well, if all these processors are on the machine at the same time, they can't all have existed exactly the same memory locations. But it's convenient to actually give them those addresses. Those addresses are then translated into real addresses that the memory, therefore, there is a page somewhere, some piece of memory that mapping occurs to. And this virtual to physical mapping is very important. Typically, on high-performance computing, we'll probably only have one process that we're really interested running on the core. However, there's some operating system stuff as well, and we have to deal with virtual memory. So the way that virtual memory works is typically you will get the memory divided up into little blocks. And most the default on, say, Linux installations, on most installations, is there's lots and lots and lots of little 4K blocks, 4 kilobytes of memory all over the place. when you do a memory allocation, Linux doesn't actually give you any real memory. It just makes a little record of, okay, you've got 16 megabytes. I'll take that outside of a pool, and then when somebody else asks, I can determine whether or not I can still give them some memory. Only when you come to touch the memory and say, I actually want that memory address that you gave me, because it will have given you a memory address, to a pointer to somewhere in memory, does it actually go and find you a physical page and then give you, say, now you can actually start to use that page. The first time, therefore, that you actually touch memory can be slightly longer than other times that you touch memory. Those 4K pages, well, we've just said there's this mapping. The processor needs to know how to do the mapping. And this is where the translation lookaside buffer goes. So if we imagine our cache hierarchy, our memory hierarchy, a bit like going to a library and having lots and lots of books. Out there is the library. We can go and get whatever books we want. But we can only take out a certain number at a time. It may be, say, 12 or 15 books or whatever. Those are the cache lines that we can then bring into our bookshelf. And then we can take, that's our L2 cache. Then from the bookshelf, we can take two or three for our desk. That's our L1 cache. And then we can open it up and actually look at the data. Okay, so we can use that type of analogy for how we use the caches. The TLB, instead, is a list of, okay, if I go to the library, where's the math section, where's the chemistry section, etc. Because just getting to the library, I still don't know where that actual data is. The translation lookaside buffer does the mapping between what you're interested in and where in the library you have to go. Okay. So in this particular example here, we can look and see a virtual mapping of F000, maybe pointing over here. You can see the virtual addresses can be in some completely different order to where the physical ones are. Typically, we have these 4 kilobyte pages. So one of the effects of this is that, and you can sort of see this from that example where we were doing the cache line, if we're going through memory, there's something called a prefetcher that if it sees that you get into a pattern of, oh, you keep jumping 8 bytes ahead or 64 bytes ahead, once you've done it a few times, the hardware prefetcher says, okay, I reckon you're going to want that next thing. So I'm going to start fetching that data ahead of time. So it's all very nice, very clean, works for you. Sometimes your code can put in official software prefetch instructions to do the same thing. The problem is that the hardware normally can't see beyond the page boundary because it doesn't know where the next page is for your physical to virtual mapping. So the prefetching in the hardware tends to stall when you get to the edge of a page boundary. Now, if we only have a 4K page, you can see that even as once we've gone beyond the cache line size, then as we increase further and further, we'll get fewer of those prefetches. That's one effect as to why you continued to see things going down for a little way beyond the 64 bytes that we were saying was the cache line size. Now, if we have to make a call to say where is the physical to virtual mapping, virtual to physical mapping, that's actually very expensive. It's as expensive as going to memory, sometimes even more so. Unless we've got some special tricks that I won't talk about with hardware page walkers and so on. So what we want to do is we want to minimize that. So we want to say, well, okay, instead of just being able to say linear algebra section and say alkenes in chemistry or whatever, really specific places, we want to be able to see bigger areas. So what we can do is we can actually change the size of the pages. So instead of 4K pages, rather small ones, we can say, look, make your pages bigger. Linux allows us to do this. The hardware allows us to do this. And this means we're much better positioned to try and, for example, get those prefetches going or just not make misses at all. The way this is implemented in Linux is there is a library called libhugeTLBFS, a bit of a mouthful. And then if you link against that, and then you simply set an environment variable, then you suddenly get these bigger pages. And that could have an impact on your application. If you have your own application, you should have a look at this and see whether or not it can give you a performance boost. In the past, there were certain things to do with the TLB that meant we got a 40% performance boost on some applications. That's not what you would expect now, but 2 or 3% or so may be possible, and it's for free. So, the final exercise of the morning is a very quick one. It's to go back to the first example you did and simply link against that library and set the environment variable. In two different ways, you can either, first of all, just say, yes, I want this. And the second one is actually to say the page size that you're looking for. There are a variety of different page sizes that are available. Typically, it will switch from a 4K page to a 2 megabyte page. But you can sometimes, some architectures will allow you a gigabyte or more. This one here, we're setting 64 megabytes as the page size. So if you could just try running that. I tried this, admittedly, on the Cray machines, which you now don't have access to. So I'm not quite sure what the effect would be on Pilatus, but I'm hoping if you record the numbers you've seen the first time you run without the huge TLBFS, just to see approximately the minimum you got when you were running with large strides. So to say 80 or 128 bytes when you'd already bottomed out. Can you see an effective bandwidth increase by using this? And on the Cray I could, but on the Intel I'm not too sure. Shaking of a head already, so I'm not sure. So in this next session, we'll just have a quick look at parts of the memory hierarchy, particularly on, in the serial fashion, that are the cache and the TLB. The TLB is not something that we normally really spend much time with. And here, we're just going to be showing you a quick trick, so to speak, that sometimes can improve your application performance that doesn't require much effort at all. So the important first slide is just simply to say this. Go back many years, and everyone was obsessed with floating point performance. And if you go back far enough, floating point performance was all the limiting factor. Getting the data to the floating point units was never really a problem. That era died quite some time ago. Now we're more and more getting to the stage where the flops are free, or a lot of processing power is free, and memory bandwidth and memory accesses are what is really the problem. Memory accesses, memory bandwidth, memory sizes, they're not able to grow at the same rate as we've been able to get away with Moore's law, the processing power increase that we've had. So most applications that we see need to find a better way of using the memory hierarchy, better way of using the cache, the translation, lookaside buffer, etc. So a cache hierarchy. So some of you may be quite familiar with this, but some of you may be less. We're doing the same thing, the same set of instructions, to lots and lots and lots of pieces of data. And this can be just streaming through memory, grabbing the next piece of data, doing exactly what we did to the piece of data before. Maybe two or three arrays, and we're adding A and B together to form C, element by element. So there's a good chance that if you had to get access to a piece of data somewhere, you also will need the surrounding data or some data nearby. This is what we call spatial locality. So often algorithms just go through adjacent elements in memory. Sometimes you might actually jump a little further. And this is why we have these levels of cache, for our spatial locality and our temporal locality. Now, what's the characteristics of the caches? Well, there's an expense with getting caches smaller and higher bandwidth and lower latency, and that's why we don't just simply have a very big fat cache sitting on the processor. There's a lot of transistors. If you look at modern multi-core processors, you'll find that the actual execution units only take up a smallish part of the die at times, And there's a lot of other stuff there, and that's all these caches. Now, caches also have an important effect in terms of how we actually load data into them. So if we say, I just want to load a particular byte at a particular memory location, to do with that spatial locality that we talked about, and also particularly the way that memory works. So this is electrical engineering. I would go and ask an electrical engineer, because this is not my field, but I do know enough of reading just to know what I need to know here about how it works. It's very expensive out in memory to actually grab one piece of data, because typically the memory fires up effectively a large band of different memory locations, and then you only grab a piece of them. It may be something like, I think, 4,000 bits or whatever get fired up at a time, and you grab whatever you need. So in order to amortize that cost, you don't just grab one bit, one eight bits, bytes. The memory hierarchy tries to grab a bigger chunk of data at a time, and this is what we call a cache line. So we may only want this little piece of data here, but when we make that load, the cache hierarchy says, well, I'm going to go and load that and the surrounding data, the line that contains that. Where it defines the line, it will be on some power of two boundary. So it may be that it finds the closest 64-byte or 128-byte or whatever boundary, and then it loads in for 64, 128 bytes, etc., whatever. These cache line lengths can differ from machine to machine. You'd want it as small as possible, because if you're jumping around in memory, that's a problem if it loads in too much that you're never going to use. On the other hand, efficiency means that so because accessing main memory is quite slow, and that's main memory that's local, we've just seen that actually we can get a diagram to say that some memory is further away than other memory on a multi-core, multi-socket node, but even local memory, accessing it is slow. It takes hundreds of clock cycles. You could be getting on with something else. So particularly for that latency effect, many years ago people started to put in these local little stores that reflected what's out in main memory for some recently used data. These are called caches, and began with just one level of cache, of course. Well, we actually use cache for two reasons. One is that latency effect, certainly, but also if you have a very small piece of memory and you put it on the processor, you can actually get much higher bandwidth to it as well. So you typically have several levels of this cache. Now, we operate all our instructions have to operate on registers, floating point operations, and so on. And these, the number of registers we have may be of the order of 32, 64 registers. If you look at assembly listings, then it's dealing with registers. Things such as GPUs, they actually have enormous register sets, so much more actually larger than their caches. But here with CPUs, we have a few registers. Then we have the processor core, and then we go out to our caches. And we have different levels of cache. So L1 cache is typically very small, very high bandwidth, and low latency. It may be that it's going to take only two or three clock cycles to grab data from that L1 cache. And if you recall me saying that we can do this out of order operations to many, many more cycles than that, typically the L1 cache latency is never going to be a problem. And the bandwidth is typically very high. Then we go down to a second level cache, and then maybe a third level cache. And by the time we get out to these lower level of cache, keep building up more and more levels of cache, you tend to find that these levels are shared with other processors. So a cache is not something that you have control over. It's not like if anybody's got had experience with GPUs, shared memory, where you can control it. This is something where it's just the processor itself is saying, you've just had some data, I'm going to leave it around because you might need it again. So this needing it again or needing similar data gives us two aspects of cache that we're interested in. Recently used data has a high likelihood in many applications that you're going to use it again. So we It stays behind, so we can have something called temporal locality. It's going to be used again in a time local sense, as in it may be that in 30 clock cycles into the future, you're going to come back to that piece of data. We want to keep it there. The other thing that we have in many of our applications, or any application that's going to get really good high performance, is we go through data in a quite regular fashion. Okay, so this means that